So I start with defining concepts in open and online education. Yeah. So there's no hard definition of what's online education and open education. So therefore I say it about perceptions. What is the perception, the current perception on online and open education? I start with online education, then online versus open. Then some texts on lines on open education resources, then on open education and on MOOCs. This is a cartoon, and look at the date at the top. It's almost 20 years ago. So online education is not new. It's already more than 20 years in discussion. But there's an increased interest in online education. Many universities are publishing course material online, even have online support mechanisms, so not only the publishing of content, but also the interaction, the communities are placed online. And now, since 2 or 3 years ago, we can even have complete courses, full courses, for more than 100,000 students in MOOCs. Now that's a kind of evaluation of online. But then you have a definition question. What's online education? So this is a definition as proposed by the United States in their report. You see the reference here below. And they say there is a difference between traditional, web-facilitated, and blended hybrid online education and completely online. And you see at the bottom that online is where almost all the content is delivered online and typically has no face-to-face meetings. So the two criteria they use, in the former definition it was only content, now it's content and face-to-face meeting. So it doesn't say anything about where the student is studying. It can be at home, it can be face-to-face, it can be online. It's about the delivery mode. The delivery is online, and mostly on content related. However, in my perception, so therefore perception, in my perception, education is more than content, is more than face-to-face meetings. So it's a result of mediated experiences that are not constrained in time and distance. So that is my definition on online. It's not constrained by time and distance. And or distance, synchronous in time and distance. So it's not only applied to course material, but also to interaction between teachers, and even on exam and test, etc. Introducing open. Open means something that has to be closed. It's a contradiction. So openness means you open something, you open a door. So something needs to be closed before you can open it. In context to online education, we know already openness in open software, open access journals as scientific output, open content as creative output, open educational resources that are the educational resources of content that are open, etc. They have a similarity. The similarity is that most of them, of all of them, are for free and have an open license. Like open software, it's for free and there is an open license so that you can redistribute and remix and take that material with you. So therefore, if you talk about open educational resources, then the definition is that it are materials, content, for to support education that can freely be accessed, reused and modified, and that the intellectual properties are with the creator, that other persons can recreate, remix, redistribute the content. So if you look at open, in open software, then you have open educational resources in reusing the material so that the license is not copyright but copyleft, so you can remix and reuse it. then my perception is that openness is something about digital openness. So it's a free online availability and it has an open license. But there's more. We have an Open Education Week, Open Education. So it's not only Open Education resources, it's also Open Education. So what's Open Education then? Now, we have the Open Universities, already starting in the 1970s, Open University UK. They have an open door policy. So there is an open entry. There's no requirements for students to enter a university. Of course, they need the skills, but there is no requirements in a diploma or something else. And then the Open University introduced also the open accessibility in freedom of time, pace and place. And open programming, open to all people. So in my perception, open education is about removing the barriers. Like the example I said, opening is something to remove a barrier. When a door is closed, you can open it. Open education means that there are barriers in education and you need to remove those barriers. You need to open them. So therefore, the commission don't say we have a program on open education, but we have a program of opening up education. And opening up education is to open, to remove the barriers for learning and students. And opening up is also a verb. It makes action. An open education is just that. So in my perception, it's about removing barriers. That can be financial barriers for free. It can be legal barriers, so we can reuse it. But it can also be open entry, freedom of place and time, etc. So there are many barriers, and the barriers may change or maybe depend on the culture or language where you are living in. An example that the financial barriers in the United States are much higher because you have to pay a lot for higher education than, for example, in France or even Germany, where there is no fee for students. So there are different barriers depending on where you live and where a higher education system is. So this is a kind of picture where I mostly use, and Fred Mulder, a colleague of mine, also using this, the classical establishment of openness in the Open University, related to flexible and open access aspects of openness. And there's the emerging innovative way, focusing on financial issues, free courses like MOOCs, open educational resources, free and open licensing. And you see that there are different players. Open Coursera Consortium is now called Open Education Consortium. The Hewlett Foundation and even Open Up Slovenia are the emerging initiative on open education. Now, the last definition, perception, is about MOOC. This is a picture famous on the internet. You can Google it on. And then you see that every letter of a MOOC is discussable. When is it massive? When it's open, what is online, and what is the course. But then you can call everything a MOOC. So if it's ill-defined, you can define yourself, I have a MOOC and I will publish it, and it gives me a lot of reputation and news, etc. So that's the danger. So I was trying, what is then the definition of a MOOC? And not myself, I tried to do it with a lot of institutions and projects to develop a definition in Europe. And perhaps it's worldwide, but we did it in Europe. This is another picture. The source is from SURF, Open Education Trend Report. It's a Dutch association on ICT. And you can see there's a lot of abbreviations coming on. There's not only MOOC, but also MOOC is a micro open online course, a SPOC, a SOOC, DOC, LOC, MORE, and so forth. The numbers are increasing just to make a difference between a MOOC and others. So it's a little bit messy. So the proposal of, I think now, 7 projects that are funded by the European Commission dealing with MOOCs, we have now agreed on the following definition, that MOOC is an online course designed for large numbers of participants that can be accessed by anyone anywhere as long as they have an internet connection. So the accessibility is restricted to having an internet connection, are open to anyone without entry qualifications, and offer a full, complete course experience online for free. Of course, that's just one sentence, and we have a lot of discussion, what are the criteria for that? So, criteria, for example, when is a course a complete full course? It's not only content. So, if you publish content and you don't have a course, then you have educational content. And when it's open, then you have open educational resources as open content. But a full course includes some kind of feedback, some kind of interaction. That can be peer interaction with students, but also with academics. This has some tests and exams, etc. So that are criteria behind that. It's already published and it's now validated. So we have that definition and we made the criteria. We try to validate that with a survey. I will come back to the survey, but there's a response in Europe about 70 institutions who validated the most of the criteria we developed. Just to have the difference between Wikipedia, they say it has to be aimed at unlimited number of participants. Unlimited, what's unlimited? 1 million, 1 billion? So that's a strange definition. Open access, that's also what's open access? You have open accessibility. But you also have open access journals, so we try to define it as accessed by anyone, anywhere, as long as they have internet connections. So there's a lot of, perceptions about MOOCs, but that might be a good definition from a European perspective. And the projects I was talking about are these projects. I'm coordinating the HOME project and SCORE 2020. ECHO and EMMA are two large projects funded under the FP7 project or even the CEP innovation program. MOOC Knowledge is another project, and Sequent has some relation because we also have some quality tools on MOOCs. The HOME project is a project on a lifelong learning program about funding of €400,000. And is focusing on building on a network. So that definition and the survey I was talking about is coordinated by that HOME project, building a European network. Sequent is focusing on, like we're talking also this day, is about quality, the quality tools you can use, and not only Sequent on MOOCs, but also on online education, e-learning, etc. ECHO is focusing as an innovation program on a decentralized model, so not one MOOC platform, but to grasp diversity in languages in Europe and to try to train teachers in making their own MOOCs at the end. So they are developing MOOCs that may help teachers to make their own MOOC and even provide at the end a platform where MOOCs can be developed by teachers. EMMA is building on a centralized platform. And that centralized platform has some translation services. And you can discuss how good those translation services are. So they're providing one MOOC, for example, in Dutch, but Open University Netherlands, and it's automatic translated in English or other languages. What's automatic translated? Is the content, exams, the videos, etc.? You can have a discussion on that. SCORE 2020 is a relative new project I'm coordinating, and it's a collaboration between service centers setting up in different countries, so such in Norway, in Ireland, and even Slovenia, where is Open Up Slovenia, and what kind of support are governments and institutions doing to others to develop MOOCs, etc. And MOOC Knowledge is a project coordinated by IPTS in Sevilla, it's a research institution of the European Commission, and they are developing a questionnaire that can be developed and shared by all MOOC providers. So that's about MOOCs. But
the trends in Europe are basically the following. Europe is very keen on open education, right? So having the formal educational system and finding ways of how to combine it with the informal, right? So if a child plays a game on his phone, right, does this mean he learns, or how is this combined with his real life and formal learning? Europe is very keen on having budgets for research projects in terms of having education in each layer, right? For example, you could have projects in smart cities, but one layer would be education also, right? So how do you learn in a smart city, etc., etc.? So education is coming, it's basically pouring into each sort of, I would say, research budget and cost, etc.
Yeah, even say that in the economic crisis, there's also the relation between informal and non-formal learning, but also on the flexibility of higher education system to train the people with the right skills for jobs. So it's the unemployment rate, and then one solution, not the only, but one aspect of the solution is a flexible higher education system focusing on the right skills, need for jobs, etc. And there's always a tension between the academic standards and the flexibility, but that's different discourse. Yeah. Are there any questions about the definitions I propose? So we have the definition of online education, definition of open education resources, open education, and a definition on MOOCs. So, and I just want to show you there is not one definition; it's more perceptions. But you can work on the definition just to make things understandable and also not ill-defined.
May I just have a comment on open education, you know, because it's a concept of education being a public good, so equally accessible to all and free for students.
Yes.
This is in this connection, removing barrier and this kind of thing.
Yeah, so in a European context, it's very important that we have equality, that is equal access to education, to affordable education as well.
But how you comment if the education is payable, then it comes under Directorate or General of Internal Market and Services, not on the other directorate.
Yeah, from the European Commission Directorate.
Yes.
You already see a change since last November, where some part of education is moved to the DG of employability. I think it's a little bit another one. So you see that for 5 years ago, it was only the DG of education that was involved in education. Then it was DG Connect because of the ICT aspects. Now DG on employability is going to be involved, because of the employability aspects, and also budget moves and then responsibilities. And then you see say about the market, etc. So, yes. I think in Europe, we have a system where education is seen as a public good. It's a social dimension. That's true for primary school. That's true for secondary school. And that's mostly true for higher education. And then you see last years, then, for example, in the Open University, in the UK, they say, we increase the fee for universities to £9,000 a year.
It goes down to £6,000 now.
Now, yeah, £6,000 or £6,000, yeah, yes, last year. So there was a movement that people need to pay for higher education. Even in the Netherlands, the grant was dismissed last in January. So, but now there's another movement, a counter movement in Germany. They said no fees anymore. So there's always a tension. Primary, secondary school, yes, free, and a social dimension. Higher education, yes, not as expensive as in the United States. And the UK is between the United States and the European. So, yeah.
And maybe another comment, you know, I know. If some system is payable and the other is free, it can happen some strange things like Linux and Microsoft.
Yeah.
You know, Linux is free, it's Linus Torvalds' idea of Finland, and Microsoft is Bill Gates, but on each computer now they are using Microsoft and paying for that.
Yeah. And
why is so?
So there's always the fear of people with when you see MOOCs and OER, open educational resources, then education can be for free and can be for the mass, etc. So why should we pay for large buildings and the professors, etc., when education can be for free? Now, it's not for free. Someone has to pay.
Yes.
So there needs to be investment, etc. And there's a difference between content and course and a complete academic bachelor of master. So for academic, to become an academic, it's not only to read and learn courses and material. It's about the academic culture. So the fear was that if you don't have money, then you go to an online university with MOOCs, etc. So that will be mass education. And you have some money, you have the high academic interaction that you can be trained to a good academic. And then maybe differences. Even I heard one example, 100 years ago it was only theater, that was expensive. Then we have cinema, cinema is for the mass, and theater is more expensive. And I don't like that similarity, but you can have some similarity with education. But who knows, I don't think that we can build a complete master on MOOCs. But there's another issue, sorry for giving a long answer. But yeah, there's another issue is there the need for higher education. If you see on the in the southern hemisphere, in the BRIC countries and developing countries, there is one guy, I lost his name, who calculated the need for higher education, on tertiary education, and the number of universities we have to build every week to educate all those people. So we have to open every week 4 universities with all the buildings and staff and professors, 4 universities for 30,000 students every week the coming 20 years. Cannot be done. Can it be done with only MOOCs? No, cannot be done. So it will be a solution in between. So, yeah.
Is there time for another comment?
Of course.
comment away.
What about if materials materials are not the problem is not in paying or not paying, but they are not for everybody. They are not for everybody's eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Coming from medical faculty, so we are building MOOC based courses. And a lot of video materials,
mm-hmm.
Which are not for everybody's eyes.
Mm-hmm.
They are suitable for 6th-year students, but not for the first year, and of course not for everybody from everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And is this still MOOC? Or, for instance, surgery.
Mm-hmm.
Some video materials about surgical procedures. Teachers are thinking if everybody can see it. It's like doing a user manual for atomic bomb on the web.
Yeah, so everyone
in
can do it.
In a way, they're right.
Yeah.
But Faculty of Medicine is a huge educational institution, and medicine is important.
Yeah.
What about openness, complete openness in medical environment?
Yeah. I think there are 3 aspects in your comment.
Yeah.
The one is, when I publish video, then it's not a course. You mm-hmm. need to have more. There's also the academic interaction as a part of a course. Then you have to create examples of why we started open access journals. So scientific output articles are published in open access, so everyone can access those articles. They don't have to pay it, etc. And the great story is then, looked at the medical resources and some guy, not even academic, not even a student, made something, etc. So that are great stories. And that can be true for open educational resources and material as well. So the great story behind open education an open educational resource is alike like open access journals, is if you open your material and even your interaction and or even your courses, it will give people opportunity to look at it, and it will give the opportunity to have an more innovation, or the pace of innovation will increase, etc. So that are the good stories. Another question is, yeah, but who's looking at 1 million, 1 billion resources, etc.? How can we find it? Another issue is the ethical issue about atomic bomb, etc. We need to solve that, yes. And therefore, it's for me, it's not open education, it's opening up education. So you remove some barriers, but you cannot remove all the barriers because there are ethical issues as well.
Yeah. But I can answer even more directly. For example, at videolectures.net, right, we were asked a very direct question. Can we upload surgical videos? Mm-hmm. Right? So cutting up a body.
How to start, how to do it.
Yeah, so I mean, end it. I mean, to be honest, anyone can Google it up, to be honest. If somebody wants to make a bomb, he'll make it.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah,
it's not the right answer.
So the question, our answer was, it's not appropriate for all audiences. Mm-hmm. So what we'll do, we'll make a technical catch, right? Either you have to log in and sign in and we know who you are, or there's going to be a huge warning sign before you press play. So that is quite easy, right? So you would just meta tag the video in a different way. But maybe even a more different answer. We would have at Video Lectures you would have a large number of computer science videos, right? And within that category you would have possibly hundreds of subcategories. Data mining, and within data mining, I don't know which kind of methods or whatever. Yeah. So what happened was that you would have 10 videos from 10 people in a global community of 11 people. Right? So you would basically have videos encompassing the whole community, like this very long, long tail sort of content. But covering that community, it meant that they were gaining huge benefits from having their own videos describing some small change in a huge algorithm, whatever sort of type of thing.
Sure.
Which means that the long tail was always a benefit if the content was very rare or very much different than anything other, than the stuff that was already online. It's more of a strategic question for the medical faculty.
There's a comment from Anthony.
I just wanted to add on something to what Darko was saying. Two things. First of all, there's a perception that people who advocate open education are saying that all education should be open, and that then start linking openness to quality. And that's actually a wrong perception. I mean, we usually talk about openness as a framework of policies which each institution having positioned themselves on openness matrix, if you will. And I'll be talking about that a little more. So in your example, I would say, listen, for certain types of knowledge, in my personal opinion, it's a very, very limited set. Some knowledge probably should be closed. The nuclear example was excellent. I don't think anybody's going to organize a MOOC on engineering nuclear bombs anytime soon, for very good reasons. But then on the other hand, if you look at where the trends are going, in research, it's already happening. So in research, it's already happening that several countries in Europe are now making open access mandates for research. And basically what that means is you pass a law and say if it's paid for with public money, it should be open to everybody. And again, on the ethical issues, there are loopholes where there should be loopholes in a lot of things. No. The European Commission, in its consultation document for opening up education, proposed that we start thinking about this in the education sphere. No country has implemented it yet, but a lot are beginning to speak about it. The concept that if educational materials are paid for with public money, then those educational materials should be the ownership of the public. It's going to take a few years till that happens, because in a lot of countries, lecturers still own the material they produce for the university themselves. that would change it on their head entirely. They would say that, listen, no, the government owns that material and the government's going to publish it. It will change how lectures happen, it will change, well, it'll blow up a lot of education, quite obviously. But this is the trend we're seeing, and I mean, the trend towards the default being open and closed being the exception based on certain very specified criteria. I would say that you can
definitely
see a trend going on this.
20 minutes now? Or?
And you see, all the doors in European Union in Horizon 2020 for MOOC-based projects are closed for medicine because we cannot promise complete openness.
No, no.
Yeah. So,
it can be each door is closed.
Yeah.
So it can be partial. I mean, there are many ways of. When it catches, when you start discussing it, then you start seeing ways of basically publishing it in a digestible manner, right?
Mm. Yeah.
But that's the idea of, for example, that's the idea of opening up Slovenia, right? Because nobody has done it, nobody has tested it, nobody has implemented it. So what if we do it and then transmit the best practices?
Yeah, but there are different reasons why you start with open education resource of open education. And that's not only about the pace of innovation and making it public, but also at efficiency by sharing between institutions. And that can be closed, but it's still opening up some barriers. So it's not about complete openness against complete closeness or closed doors. It's what barriers are there and what barriers can be done for the learners, for institutions, professors, for governments, etc. Even governments now, there's a hype going on open data. It's not big data and learning analytics, but open data of governmental data that should be open.
Which then again would bring in new business models and so on.
Yeah, but also ethical issues. Can you be open on everyone's salary, even my salary, or etc.? So I don't care, but yeah, some people may say, oh, that's not ethical to do that. So by opening up, you can have questions on ethical issues. Yeah. Before having a coffee break, I want to focus on what are the institutional's policies on open and online education. And then after the coffee break, on what can be said on the governmental aspect. To do that, I compare and make the results public. Now, discuss the results of three surveys. There's a survey already done at the United States. That's already conducted since 2002 on online education, and it involves more than 2,000 U.S. institutions nowadays. At the start not, but nowadays it has more than 2,000 U.S. institutions. Nothing was happening in Europe. We didn't have any survey on online education or open education. We couldn't benchmark ourselves. So therefore, the AUA, European University Association, did have a survey in the end of 2013 on e-learning and MOOCs. And that's a new survey. They did have a response of almost 250 institutions. And it was published in, I think it was November last year. But I will talk about that. And then there's the home survey, one of the projects on MOOCs, who did a survey on MOOCs. But I will discuss this, these three.
As you're speaking, I'm basically adding the links to the website with the reports and the surveys. So if anybody wants to check.
Yeah, they are on the slides as well, but yeah. You can Google them, etc. Just on this one. This is the latest US survey. And the link is there on this side. They have a regular report and can also make a comparison with, for example, fall 2003 to fall 2013 about the growth rate in the number of students taking at least one online or distance course. So then in their definition, in the early, it was only related to content. So it's not about online master, online bachelor. It's about an online course where more than 80% is delivered as content online. And you see an increase, almost 35%, but still an increase in 2013, but not as large as it used to be. But the number of students in total, both private and non-private, is still more than 5 million and increasing. They predicted last year, and I don't know in the last survey, they predicted that in 2017 or 2018 there will be more students having an online course than students in a face-to-face setting doing a course. But that was based on a growth rate, I think, on this one in 8 or 7%. So we are approaching in the United States where there are as many students taking online course as a face-to-face course. And therefore the growth rate is also decreasing. So then this is a question on online education is critical to the long-term strategy of my institution. And the blue line you see in the United States, it was less than 50%. And nowadays it's more than 70% agrees that online education has to be part of the long-term strategy of the institution. So you cannot deny it. Yes, 30% is still denying it, but 70% does it. And is online education also represented in the strategic plan of 2014? So 70% is saying in 2014 it should be, and we are not there. For private, for profit, it's 80% already who has in plan, not in plan. So that's in plan is more than less than 60. So you see that a lot of institutions want that in a strategic plan online education should be part, but it's not always there. And then about awareness on open educational resources and Creative Commons. I didn't mention Creative Commons. Creative Commons is a kind of licensing that gives the people the right to remix, redistribute the material. So this is a picture about the faculty awareness and academic leader awareness. And you see that the faculty there is not aware about what open educational resources and Creative Commons is. Who did know about Creative Commons? Was anyone? Yes, one, two, only two, three? Creative Commons. Who did know about Creative Commons? Yeah. So yeah, perhaps there's a similarity with the United States as well there. Then the second survey was published in November by the AOA. Here's the link at the bottom. This is the complete title. This is the picture of the report. And they have a question. Does your institution offer any of the following online courses, online degree programs? So not only courses, online degree programs, blended degree programs or joint online learning programs, etc. So you see that out of their 250 institutions who responded, 82% is offering online courses. Blended courses even more, but surprisingly, it also has online degree programs, is already 39%. So what I'm mentioning is not a course, it's an online program is already offered. And even, and that's also why I'm saying it's not about only the perception for the added value for the learners. When you have opening up your material, you can have also joint degrees and joint online programs. And it's already 40% is offering some kind of joint program. So that's in Europe now. So. And what kind of IT systems are we using in Europe? And you see that we have a lot of online access to libraries, access to computer rooms, Wi-Fi. Okay, that's very standard. Email accounts, licenses to software, online study catalog. And then it becomes less. So I think these things are already common. Every university already offers this. But that's not an online degree. It's not an online course. There are facilities for that. And I think 24% is offering online examinations. I think it's very high. I was surprised. I think it was 5% or something like that. It's already 24% is already offering online examination. So when we're talking about later this today about quality, it's not about quality of libraries and access, but it's also quality of portfolio and examinations. Because these are more standardized quality aspects, and these are more to the learning aspects. When you look at the quality aspect, then the AOA study has two questions. Is there an internal quality assurance consideration with e-learning? And is there an external quality system? So only 29% has a quality system on e-learning. And an external quality assurance is only in 23. Out of the 250 institutions who responded. So you can read the comments in the report itself. I only want to demonstrate there is a strategic issue of including online education in your strategic plan of the institutions. In Europe, a lot of things is happening on online education, but we need to work on the quality assurance.
If I can just give an example. At MIT, you would know that there's the open courseware. So they're friends of ours. They spend, I think, 70% of their resources, or even more, 80% of it, 70% of the resources on getting the quality assurance on the materials.
Yeah.
So they have 20,000 courses published. These are all MIT courses. And there's this special group that's been developing ways of doing it super efficiently for the last 10 years. And most of the time on staff is on getting it right. So licenses and all the other aspects which come into the quality assurance.
Yeah.
Just as a sort of figure.
Yeah. And then there might be a difference between what MIT is doing in Open Course Consortium because it's additional quality assurance.
Yeah.
And what we are advocating is when online education becomes regular part of programs either, it integrated quality with the existing quality systems. So not developing a separate system, but to incorporate it. But that we will discuss with the tools this afternoon on Sequent. So institutional e-learning policies, you did have the United States figure where who said 80% or 70% we should have a plan, and there's only 50% who has a plan. In Europe, it's also 50% has a strategic plan on online education e-learning. But it's under development, so it will be increased the coming years. What are the objectives for e-learning? And again, the most things are related to effectiveness and flexibility. Flexibility of learning, like I said, for also flexibility of higher education system and need for jobs, is the flexibility aspect. And to increase the effectiveness in the classroom, more learning opportunities on campus, where not on campus, etc. So those are the four related to online education. The last survey I want to talk about is from my own project on MOOCs, and then it's about institutional MOOC strategies in Europe. It was published last week, so it's fresh on the results now. You can find the link on edu.au there. You can have the report itself. What we did is we did take the questions from the United States in those surveys. And we repeated some questions for the European institutions. So you see, there is the US survey 2013, US survey 2014, and our home survey in Europe in 2014. So it's published 2015, but it was in the last quarter of 2014. The main difference, has MOOC offering is much more in Europe than in the United States. In Europe, we are very much more active in MOOCs than the United States. More and more institutions in Europe are offering MOOCs. even is planning to add a MOOC, if you count those two, more than 70% is already having a MOOC or planning to have a MOOC. In the United States, it has decreased in planning. So the hype is over in America, in the United States. And in Europe, it's not a hype anymore, 70%. It's becoming mainstream.
That was also something that the Gartner hypercircle, when you...
Yeah.
So you can clearly see that MOOCs are coming into the mainstream education.
Yeah, but in the United States, it's going downhill.
Yeah.
And in Europe, so for the... Perhaps we are now ahead of the United States. Or we are still, and we need to go down again. So where are we in the hype circle? Are we already not at the top hill, and so we are behind the United States, or the United States is not mainstream and beyond? It's becoming, so I don't know, but these results, and that's, perhaps I said it here, in the AOA study, so from the European Association, was in 2013, they said 85% of European institutions is having a MOOC or is planning a MOOC. In our survey now, 1 year later, it's 71.7%. So it's consistent. In America, it has decreased from 14.3 to 13.3. So this kind of large difference between the United States and America, I cannot explain. Perhaps it's biased by the number of institutions replied to both my survey and the AOA survey. But it's a large difference. About the bias, we did have almost all institutions of Portico replied in our survey. And so it's covering one country. We're making one country report now, and it has the same results as this one. So I cannot say it's biased, because in Portico all the institutions are involved in the survey. It's a large difference between the States and Europe.
Sorry, can you tell a bit about the sample of institutions that answered the question?
Yeah, that was in the beginning, United
because
States.
I simply can't believe that numbers in both of surveys. 71% having a MOOC?
Yeah, it's about...
A MOOC with your definition that you use.
What
is the definition?
No, it's about... the question was the same question as in America, and that was the question, status of MOOC offering,
okay,
and, the, and those...
How is the MOOC defined?
It's not defined. And not in the United States, and not in Europe. So it's about what's the common perception of the MOOC.
Okay, then maybe.
Yeah.
Otherwise, 70%. I'm sorry, I can't believe that.
No, so now if you look at, then you say Portugal.
Why would you say it's not?
In Portugal, they have 13 institutions, higher education systems. 12 responded in our survey.
But
12, so it's Portugal. Then I say, Portugal, I make a country report, and then in Portugal, 68% is having a MOOC or planning to have a MOOC within a short notice. So then I say, why bias in Portugal is representative to this study?
Yeah. Why the skepticism? Yeah. Why
would you say because according to the definition that you gave us,
yeah,
I don't think it's possible. Bearing in mind what were the numbers a few years ago, that they would be able to develop courses and even degree programs in that percentage.
No, most of them only have one or two MOOCs.
Yeah.
So it's not about complete program, it's one or two MOOCs. And
I wonder if they count online or open education in that category. Maybe.
Now, if you look at the number of MOOCs now offered in Europe, it's more than 1,000. Hmm. So if it's one MOOC per institution, so it's 1,000 institutions.
Yeah, but and then 4,000 institutions.
Yeah,
Europe.
So that's 25%, but who's planning?
70.
No, 70 is per having a MOOC or planning to have a MOOC.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's those two together. And I think that the AOA study already confirmed that they said it was already 58%. And it's more than 50% of their institutions replied to them. And then you can say, okay, it's biased because the sample is biased. But those last difference. And even my example of Portugal, where all the higher education institutions reply to our survey. So I think there will be a bias, but that cannot explain those last differences. For compensating to the bias, we make a distinction between institutions offering a MOOC and all the institutions, just to say what the difference is, if you already have a MOOC or not. This is also a question used in the United States. Are credentials given to MOOCs, will that give confusion to higher education? So not only a certificate of completion, but a real credits to a MOOC. In the United States, it was only said in 2013, more than half agree on that it will give confusion. In our survey, most of them disagree with the statement. And that can be true because of we have the ECTS system and we have a quality assurance system that people are not afraid that credentials to MOOCs will have a disruptive effect or make confusion to higher education. In the United States, there is the perception that it will have. Again, a large difference between the States and Europe. This is also a large difference between the States and Europe, is the importance of to learn about online pedagogy. So the pedagogical and didactical approach of courses. Again, a large majority in Europe agrees that it's important. In the United States, it's not that important. Another difference is that MOOCs are seen as a sustainable method, not a method, but sustainable methods of offering courses. In Europe, most agree. In the United States, most of them disagree, and the number of institutions disagreeing is increasing. Then there's another question repeated in both surveys. How well are MOOCs meeting the objectives of an institution? Again, in Europe, most of them saying it will meet most or some of the objectives of the institutions.
Yeah, but they must be part of objectives first,
right? Yeah, so they have to define objectives. And sometimes institutions say we have to be on the train because everyone's on the train and then we have MOOCs. But then we ask about what are the primary objectives, why an institution is involved in MOOCs. And again, it's the US, both US surveys and the home survey in Europe. There are a lot of similarities. Primary objective to have and generate income, learning about scalability, exploring cost, supplement on-campus situation are not that important. The most important issue is to increase the visibility of the institution, so its marketing and reputation. In the United States is to drive student recruitment, and in Europe it's more about flexible learning opportunities, and those flexible learning opportunities are most important for institutions not involved yet in MOOC. So they have the perception that it will have a flexibility opportunity. Well, institutions who have a MOOC, it's like the similar to the United States. Then if you look at a cluster of objectives and we asked what are the relevance of different objectives, then you see that the financial reasons are not that important. Most important are, again, reputation, visibility, the innovation area, and to the demands of learners and society. So based on those surveys I presented, we can say that European associations, institutions are more involved in MOOCs than in the US. That the number of European institutions in MOOCs is increasing, while in the US is decreasing. And MOOCs are perceived as a sustainable method for offering courses in Europe. They have a increasing positive attitude. They have a positive experience meeting some of the objectives of institutions. And the most dominant objective is to increase institutional visibility and using MOOCs for reputation aspects. Well, in the US, it's primarily related to reach new students, recruit students. In Europe, it's seen as to have a new target group, so to reach new students and flexible learning opportunities. Let me state that all the commercial activities are centralized in the United States. So you even see that the number of MOOCs in the US platforms, the majority are now, or almost now, from Europe. The largest increase on the MOOCs on the US platforms like Coursera, edX, Udacity is provided by European institutions. So if Europe is embracing MOOCs and the hype is over in the United States, why are we giving our intellectual aspects, all our courses, to the United States providers? There is no big MOOC provider in Europe. We have small MOOC providers, iVersity in Germany, Open MOOC in Spain. In the UK you have Future Learn. So they are language based. And most of our efforts, putting our intellectual aspects, our courses, are going to the United States. Strange. Something to think about.
But that's why we are developing all these technologies for translation and all that, and ICT systems. Because the Americans basically have one pipeline and that's it.
Yeah.
Right? We need like multiple ones.
Yeah, Europe is multiple.
That's the nature of the beast.
Yeah. But we have to embrace that.
Yeah.
So the nature of the beast in Europe, education is a social dimension. Education should be affordable and accessible. Therefore, MOOCs are important as one tool, not the tool, one tool. So it's embraced in Europe. Therefore, we need to have the beast on diversity in cultures, diversity in languages. We need to solve that.
I mean, not to be provocative, but has anyone taken a MOOC? Yeah. So I was doing my master's in London, and I remember in 2012, the first MOOCs came out. I think it was the... So what I was doing databases, of course, at UCL. And then I was taking the databases on Coursera. So this one was sort of like the first MOOC. And it fit perfectly. I mean, it was a winning combination. And the beauty of it was that basically all these dimensions came out that we started meeting in Starbucks. So in the evening we would meet, like all of us, if we were taking the Coursera MOOC at UCL, and then we would talk, and then you would meet people, you know, discuss whatever from stuff from the course, but also business opportunities, whatever. So I agree with the dimensions.
Yeah. Any comments? Because I started with the US survey, then the AUA survey on e-learning and MOOCs, and then the home survey on MOOCs only. And the commonality is that online education has to become part of institutions and institutional strategy.
One thing that we visited edX, mm-hmm, 10 days, probably 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
So the catch with the Americans is that they don't have technology. They have just, you know, they have the edX platform and software, and that's it. So they just, what they do is they just built it, and they're using it. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
But in Europe, we have all these like small chunks of technology that we can attach to it and make it smaller, bigger, modular, whatever,
mm-hmm,
different languages, learning analytics, smart analytics, because we have all this kind of a research and development back catalog. So
therefore, I'm advocating in Europe not to build one big MOOC platform in all the languages and all the tools, to have a more decentralized model.
Yeah.
A decentralized model, for example, like MOOC Knowledge Project is working on the research questions and a database for research. And then we have a tool on translation. And then an institution or a country can adopt those tools and make their own platform, etc. So it's still about scalability, but then not on an American way that there is a global platform, etc., but more not completely decentralized, but something in between. Yeah. And again, one issue we are talking about later today is about the quality issues. Quality, it is becoming, online education is becoming, is mainstream. MOOCs is becoming mainstream. The quality issue is not always there. So, yeah, we need to discuss that. Other comments, then we have a coffee break, and then I have a short talk about the governmental aspects, and then, yeah.
Will the slide be available after the
workshop
today?
Yeah, yeah. I think
that... website, or...?
You have to talk to Davor, but okay. Yeah, but he said already that they will be published, all the slides on the website. Yeah, so you don't...
Because I didn't remember all the figures. And
it's already there?
Yeah, it's already online.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You can see the report. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but the links are in the slides, and then you can have all the three reports. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I ask one thing, because I was running late? And my colleague was asking before, which the numbers are quite unbelievable in the sense that maybe it's the question of sampling, because I was looking at the countries that are responding.
Yeah.